You're listening to Wiretap with Jonathan Goldstein. Today's episode, Get With It.
All morning, I just can't seem to get my act together. Mm-hmm. I'm just completely out of sorts, you know?
Maybe it's what you ate last night. I mean, like, eggs always make you sluggish, and you had the deviled eggs, and then it was, like, lots of cheese for dinner, and you had ice cream after on top of it.
How do you know what I had for dinner last night?
Well, was that your cousin Sandy's engagement party?
How did you know that I was at my cousin Sandy's engagement party last night?
Well, you told me you were going.
No, I didn't mention that to you.
And
what's more, how do you know exactly what was on the menu and what I ate?
Well, that's just it. I thought yesterday. Oh, no. It was your mom told me that. That's so weird. I could have sworn it was you. She also, her stomach was upset a bit, too.
You ran into my mother?
No, I just talked to your mom yesterday.
You talk to my mother on the telephone?
Sometimes. I mean, we've always kind of kept in touch. I mean, she's kind of like family. I mean, we keep in touch. And
are you kidding me?
No.
You're not joking.
You're so surprised.
I'm very surprised.
I know your mom since I'm a kid. After all these years, you don't know that I talk to your mom once in a while.
Come on. Wait, let me get this straight. You called my mother up on the telephone,
mm-hmm.
and you talked about what I ate last night at my cousin Sandy's engagement party.
One thing led to another, and we talked about the function, and it sounded very, very nice. And then she said she wasn't feeling well, and then she said you weren't feeling well also. And then, you know, of course, I asked questions.
I'm sorry. I feel like someone's just dropped acid in my drink. Wait, you're not putting me on, are you?
No, I'm almost tempted to say, are you putting me on? I mean, I know your family, and...
You know, my mother has never mentioned this to me. This is the first that I'm hearing of this. I know your mother. I mean, I don't call her up on the telephone.
No, she's not much of a conversationalist, my mom.
But I mean, not least of all, because, you know, she's a fine woman. But, I mean, it would just feel a little inappropriate, don't you think?
You just don't have things in common. I mean, your mom have a lot in common. I mean, your mom's she's fun. She's a fun person. She's with it.
No, she's not. I call her up on the telephone because she's my mother, and I like to keep in touch with her. I can't. What do you talk about with her?
I don't know. She's a very, I mean, you know, we talk about relationships, we talk about your life.
You talk about me?
Well, I mean, you're a common, you know, common denominator there. You're her son, you're my friend. I mean, you know, yeah, sometimes, you know, when there's concerns or we want to know how you're doing and we talk.
How often do you talk?
I don't know. I mean, there's no, like, we don't have any kind of regular pattern. I mean, I don't know, like, well, once a week, twice a week, two, three times a week, four times a week.
Four times a week?
Well, I mean, not always four times a week. Sometimes less, sometimes more, give or take, you know. I mean, I don't know. You know, my mom's very busy. She's a career woman, and, you know, and, I mean, you're a very busy man. Everyone seems to be working. Your mom, you know, she's around, and she's sensitive to certain things, and we have certain things in common, I guess. I don't know.
What do you have in common with my mother?
Well, we both like racquetball. I mean, we don't play it, but we like it. We both like porcelain figurines. Sometimes she could be hurt by your behavior, and, you know, I'm me too sometimes, and we like bolster each other, like kind of give each other some kind of support. And
what do you mean support? Do you have like a little like support network for my behavior?
Network. I mean,
you sit and commiserate about the way I treat you both?
No, it's not. No, not. I mean, there are nice things to us that, you know, like you make everyone very proud, and, you know, like sometimes, I mean, I can talk to your mom sometimes if I have like some kind of big decision to make and I'm not sure, and I, you know,
can you call her up?
I can call her up.
Well, why don't you? I thought I'd help you with your decisions.
You do. But sometimes, you know, you want to go to someone who has the age and the wisdom to, you know, I mean, when I've worked as a professional party animal or any other kind of work I've ever done, like sometimes I would never have taken those steps if I didn't get that encouragement, that support. She believes in me. You know,
she encourages you to do these things, some of the things that you do?
It's not a question of encouragement. It's a question of, like, support. I mean, I don't just call your mom for business advice and stuff like that. I mean, sometimes we just talk. I mean, sometimes we just sit and watch TV together. We don't even say anything to each other. We just kind of sit and we watch and we laugh and we don't even really need to speak. And I don't know, like I think I got a phone call. Can you hang on a second?
Yeah, sure.
Hang on. John, can I call you back in like just a couple of minutes? Like,
yeah, sure. Okay. Is everything okay?
Yeah. Oh, I'm going to call you back, okay?
Well, who do you got on the other line?
I got, Let me call you back.
You don't have my mother on the other line, do you?
You
have my mother on the other line.
Let me just call you back in 5 minutes. Let me call you back in 5-10 minutes, okay? I'm gonna call you back in 5 minutes.
Oh, hi. You're on the other line, huh?
Yeah, I was.
Yeah.
Can I call you back? Is it okay?
Oh, it must be a pretty important phone call.
Well.
Who do you have on the other line?
I'll call you back.
Well, who's on the other line?
No one. I'll call you back.
Why don't you admit you have Howard on the other line?
Hang on 1 second. Hello?
Why wouldn't you tell me you were talking to Howard?
I didn't want to upset you. I didn't want you to think I interfere in your life.
Well, I don't get it. So now you talk to Howard on the phone? Like, how did this whole thing start?
I don't know. What can I tell you? He's always liked talking to me. You know, when you were kids and you were playing video games with your friends in your rooms, Howard would always come into the kitchen and follow me around. He'd always talk to me. He would tell me the kids are mean to him, how school was. He liked to talk to me. What can I tell you?
Yeah, but you know, now he's... I mean, it seems crazy to me. He's a grown man now.
So?
And he still calls you up on the telephone?
So?
You don't think that's a little strange?
No.
That's normal to you?
Yeah.
He talks to you more during the week than I do.
So maybe you should call your mother more often?
So you're saying I should be more like Howard, in other words?
No, but you know Howard, he's very conscientious. Well, you know, maybe if you'd let him talk to you, he wouldn't call me. He keeps telling me that he has no one to listen to him, so I guess he calls me for that.
So you're saying this is my fault?
Well, you know, Howard didn't have what you had. His mom was a career lady. He was a latchkey kid. There was no one there at home when he came in, and he had no one to talk to. So I listened to him, and I still listen to him. Someone's got to listen to him. You know, a person can burst if they have no one to listen to them. You could make more of an effort with him, you know.
Now you make me feel bad.
You don't have to feel bad. Once in a while, you call him up and you listen to him. Indulge him. Listen. You know what I do sometimes?
What's that?
I put the phone down. I do my housework. I clean the fridge. I pick the phone back up and he's still talking. Makes him happy.
Well, all right. So, all right. I guess I'll go give him a
call.
Yeah,
that's nice.
Okay. All right. I'll talk to you later on.
Take care, sweetie.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Hello?
Howard?
Hello?
Howard?
Hello?
Yes, Howard.
Yes, this is Howard. Who's this?
It's Jonathan.
Jonathan?
Yes.
Jonathan who?
It's Jonathan Goldstein, Howard. Can you turn down the TV?
Hang on one second. I'm going to turn down the TV.
Okay.
Hang on. Hi.
Hi. What's going on over there?
I had some anime on here. It was hard to. Hi. You caught me by surprise there.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I can't think of the last time you called here.
Really?
I thought it was the utility company.
Uh-huh.
To what do I owe the pleasure of the phone call?
Well, you know, just calling to say hi, just calling to chit chat. That's all.
Yeah?
I mean, I call you sometimes. I call you once in a while, right?
Well, a while. It depends what a while. Well, you haven't called my house in, it's been, I don't think I've heard from you since I broke my little toe. Remember? I was trying to play croquet with my foot. I was kicking the croquet ball there.
Right.
Remember that whole... Aki sack croquet thing. I thought I could make a hybrid sport.
Uh-huh, yeah, that didn't pan out so good.
No, I broke my toe.
Yeah.
That was nice. She phoned. That was a few years ago.
Yeah, well, I guess usually, you know, I could just count on hearing from you. But, you know, I just thought I'd phone you up and,
yeah?
You know, see what's going on. You know, what's new?
Nothing. Are you still mad at me about talking to your mom?
No, that's cool. You know, you guys have your thing, and I apologize. I sort of flew off the handle.
No, it's no problem. I mean,
What?
What? What was that?
No, I was nothing. I was just asking you what.
No, I said what?
No, I mean before you said what? What were you? What did you just say?
I swallowed.
Oh.
I had some soda.
Okay.
I got to admit I'm at a loss here. I don't think I was really prepared to hear from you, kind of thing. Usually when I call you and stuff, I usually have some like notes and stuff, and I have some notes here that I kind of keep on my phone. I'm just kind of looking through.
What do you have there?
Just topics, you know, points of conversation we speak to, things I usually want to bring up.
Like some kind of like some kind of outline or something.
Yeah, just to be a little more sophisticated.
Like you have like talking points.
Yeah, some things are conversational. Some things, you know, things to I thought you might find interesting or fascinating, or you know, kind of like I was going to mention. Like I ate 3 liters of ice cream the other day. I was going to talk about that, but I haven't really fleshed that one out. I was going to call you next week about that one.
Uh-huh.
What do I got here? I swallowed a plum. I forgot to chew. Dead bird on sidewalk. This one there. We've got another one here. Rope tricks. Going for rope tricks. And I was going to get a hamster. I thought that was interesting.
Oh, yeah?
You know, yeah. You know, I went down to the pet store and I was, you know, I'm just kind of curious. You know, before I buy the animal, I want to see if it's going to fit my lifestyle, if it's going to fit my life. So I kind of put on my jeans, which I keep kind of snug. I want to see if it was going to fit in my pocket because I want portability in a pet.
But you wanted to see if the hamster was going to fit in your pocket?
Yeah. And I tell this to the guy, and I start putting the hamster in my pocket, and he starts to freak out.
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing? That's an animal. I'm like, I know it's an animal.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to darn well see if it's going to fit in my pocket. I said, this is my pet. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be investing. Anyway, we got into a real row, and I told him I'm not how he's going to keep a business going if that's going to be his attitude. I mean, God, you go into a store, you're going to buy something. You don't just, you know, you try on a shirt. Hello? Hello?
This is Earl.
Hey, Earl Hamilton?
That's right.
Hi.
Is Jonathan?
Yes, that's right. This is Jonathan Goldstein.
Hi, I was expecting your call.
Doug Carnell, the new CBC program director here.
He mentioned you were going to call.
Right. He actually requested that I phone you.
Right.
He sort of told me that I had to call you. So.
Yeah, he had mentioned that you were looking for some new channels of distribution, trying to build a brand a little bit.
Of Wiretap. Yeah, I'm not really sure what he had in mind. I know that Doug Carnell used to work in commercial radio, and
well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we just back it up a little bit? And
uh-huh.
I'll just I was thinking that Wiretap is the Jonathan brand, and the Jonathan brand is Wiretap, and both those brands I think are scalable.
Uh huh.
We need to get really defined about what our plan is.
Okay.
And then we'll talk a little bit about what the deliverables are, and then I'll leave you with a kind of action plan that you can follow up on.
Earl?
Yeah.
I got to be honest with you. I don't know what you're talking about. I know that Doug Carnell wants to attract a younger demographic. I'm actually kind of confused about this whole thing.
All right. Well, why don't we begin at the beginning?
Okay.
Why don't you tell me a little bit about what you do?
Okay. Well, you know, I have a radio show here, and
right. I can't actually say that I've heard it because I'm in the United States. We don't get CBC down here.
Okay. So you actually you haven't heard my radio program.
I was sent a couple of copies of it, but I haven't had a chance to listen to it yet. But I think I understand your format.
Okay.
You're like a Jerry Springer meets Warm and Fuzzy. Mom, apple pie. Am I right?
Actually, no. It's not unlike Jerry Springer because, you know, it's sort of like there's people working their problems out.
My high school drama teacher, he taught me that in conflict is drama, right? So you mm-hmm. pursue conflict for drama.
Yeah.
So that's the essence of what made Jerry the brand that he is.
Right.
Talking about $100 million a year in syndication. I'm sorry, do you not want to make money? Is that not what we're here for? Because I think you probably do. I think we all want to make money.
I don't know.
You're not one of those artists who's afraid to make money, are you? No, I'm kidding. Listen, I think you really need to think about what your commitment is to this brand. Because I started out by talking about what brand we're going to build here. And that brand is the Jonathan Goldstein brand. You need to think in terms of four things.
Uh-huh.
The brand equity protection, the brand essence, the brand experience, and the brand extension. And when that all comes together...
Yeah, I have no idea what any of that means.
Right. When that comes together... That's what I call brand harmonization, okay?
Uh-huh.
You've heard of the Beatles, right?
Yeah, I've heard of them.
They sung in harmony.
Mm-hmm.
And that harmony made them very rich. And right. That's what we're going to do for the brand Jonathan Goldstein.
Uh-huh. You know, though, Earl, I don't know if you, like, how much of the, you know, the CBC you understand. Like, there is no, there's no profit.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't know that much about the CBC,
mm-hmm.
but I think of that as one of my strengths coming into the situation.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not mired down in where we were in the past, in history, and what was happening yesterday, and who in the office brings in a tuna fish sandwich and it smells of the office. You know what I'm talking about.
Okay, but, I mean, you know that there's no advertising on the, you know what I mean? It was like we're not trying to attract more sponsors.
Again, not a problem for me because advertising is dead. Nobody even says advertising anymore. They talk about marketing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about synergies, edutainment, infotizing. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I don't even think those are real words.
We need to manipulate people to want to listen to you. Why, when I have all these choices, do I want to choose the brand called Jonathan Goldstein? It's the same as when I'm in the supermarket aisle and I have 40 different breakfast cereals. What's going to make me pick up the Kellogg's Corn Flakes? Do you have any ideas why you pick up that box?
Because,
I'll tell you why.
Yeah.
Because we tell you which box of cornflakes is going to make you happy. It's going to make you live forever. It's going to give you not just longevity, but super sex potency.
Yeah, you see, I don't know that my show is going to make anyone more potent. It might make them laugh or...
All right, Jonathan, are you familiar with have you ever heard the term CRM?
No.
It's a term that I use in my job, in my industry.
Mm-hmm.
CRM refers to customer relationship management, okay?
Okay.
And we'll take you, for instance. You're kind of a lovable loser along the lines I see of like a Dobie Gillis.
Wait, excuse me?
Like Gilligan on Gilligan's Island, right?
Okay.
Like every man can relate to him because he's kind of a nobody. He's a schlump. He's going nowhere and he's stuck in a dead-end job and he's just a nobody.
Well,
but they can laugh at you just like they can laugh at themselves because you give them permission to.
Okay.
You're not you know what I'm saying? I'm not offending you.
Okay.
You're not like Brad Pitt, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You're just some schlumpy guy in a miserable dead-end position who's got nothing.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of people can relate. They got their schmucky little house in Schmuckville. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
They come home with a fat wife every night, you know, the kids screaming, the whole thing. We need you to be a diversion for these people, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to use the term FMCG, which is a fast-moving consumer good, okay?
Okay.
So that's frequently purchased consumer items, like food.
Okay.
And what we're going to do is we want to extend your brand into the minds of the consumer as being the endorsed brand, like a Kit Kat. You know what a Nestle Kit Kat is? You ever have one?
Yeah.
Okay. So you are going to be like a Nestle Kit Kat on the air.
Kit Kat?
Yeah. You're going to be the Kit... Yeah, I like Kit Kats. Do you like Kit Kats?
They're okay.
Yeah, they're delicious.
I like them okay.
Everyone likes Kit Kats.
Uh-huh.
So first we're going to get into a little R&D.
R&D?
Research and development.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll get what people want in you, and then we define you, and then we relaunch you.
When you say relaunch?
If you want to be, you know, the alphabetti spaghetti or the Heinz baked beans of your product category, that's the way we proceed. I mean, I'm not telling you how to do your job, so I'm, you know, obviously you're not going to tell me how to do my job. I'm just saying we're going to relaunch you.
Yeah.
And we're going to create the niche where people need the Jonathan Goldstein Wiretap brand in their life. We'll co-create it.
Yeah, I really don't know a lot about this sort of thing. I feel a little in over my head, I guess.
You don't need to know about it. I know about it. That's uh-huh. why you hired me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't actually, but yeah.
Okay, so believe it or not, you're going to be able to help me with this rollout.
Oh, yeah?
Who knows you better than you know you, right? I don't know you.
Uh-huh.
Tell me a little bit about what kind of celebrities you have on your show.
Okay, you see, yeah, I don't have celebrities on the show. You know, like I'll have my friend, I have a friend Howard who, you know, is always up to different things and he'll call up and my mom.
Okay, so I think right away you need to look for some kind of recognizable names to get on your show.
Yeah, it's not that kind of show. You know?
Yeah, but again, you're getting stuck in old thinking, old way of thinking.
But I like some of those. You know what I mean? I mean, these are things that the show is predicated.
We'll take the essence and we'll preserve it. But let's just think, just for a minute. Let's say I told you tonight mm-hmm. you had a fantasy guest on. Who's the guest? Kanye West.
The rapper?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, he wouldn't...
Okay.
I wouldn't say call him a fantasy guest,
okay,
you know?
Don't tell me your mom, because every day that I open up my Entertainment Weekly or my Us magazine or my People magazine, they don't have your mom on the cover. You know who they have on the cover?
Who's that?
Well, it changes every week, but they have people on the cover, like, who everybody knows. I don't know. They might have Sheryl Crow. You know who that is?
Yeah.
She's a singer. She's married to Lance Armstrong, or going to get married to him.
Right.
He had cancer. You ride a bicycle. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a celebrity, Sheryl Crow. Now, look, I know that your mother is probably a sweetheart, right?
Yeah, she's all right.
Yeah, my mom's all right, too.
Yeah.
But I know the difference between my mom and Robert Downey Jr. You know who Robert Downey Jr. is?
Yeah.
Now, do you think that Robert Downey Jr. knows who your mom is? See, that's my point exactly. Your mom probably knows who Robert Downey Jr. is, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference between regular people and celebrities. Listen, there's two kinds of people in this world. People who watch TV and people who are on TV. Now ask yourself, which one do you want to be?
You see, this I'm not doing TV, you know. It's a radio show, you know.
Jonathan, baby, media these days is all over the place. You think Dave Letterman started on TV?
He did, I think, actually. He was a weatherman for years.
It was a different era.
Uh-huh.
Listen, I feel like we're drifting a little bit, so... Let me just run you through my vision, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's just say, I'm just thinking off the top of my head. Let's say you have a show opener. It sounds something like this. I don't know if you can hear me. I got you on speaker, and I apologize for that, but can you hear this?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. All right, it's Jonathan Goldstein, Wiretap. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Ba 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 ba. Tonight, we're happy to have on Fiona Apple with her dazzling new CD. And maybe some Desperate Housewives are coming on tonight. And maybe whoever won the Emmys this year. And, you know, you get the idea. Okay, then the show takes there's a little beat,
wait,
right?
Wait, like...
Just stick with me through this. So the show takes a little beat.
Right.
After the celebrity stuff. Then you go to the pull of heartstrings, right? Maybe something like this. And then we go to... We're going to slow things down for heroes, hope, and heartbreak, right? Hurricane victims, heartbreak tales of survival, daring rescues, and how we're going to help, right? I don't know if you're hearing this because I got you on speaker. I can't hear you. But I'm just saying. And then we're going to finish big, right? We're going to finish with something like this. Because everyone wants to leave with a smile on their face, right? Thanks a lot for coming on the show. It's been great. We'll see you next week when we have Vince Vaughn and Ben Stiller and blah, 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 blah. You know, you do this for a living. You can round it out. You see what I'm talking about?
Look, it is my style. You know, I couldn't pull something like that off.
I think you need to think in terms of this kind of conjugation of that sentence, okay? That wasn't my style. That's not who I was. Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
When you were in grade school,
mm-hmm.
were you the last guy picked when they played team sports in school?
Well,
you get hit with the dodgeball, your glasses flew off. Is that going to stop you from being the next governor of California? I don't think so. So maybe where your show was is that you had some kind of like I don't know what you had, some sad guy who had a disease on your show talking about a disease and how, poor me, I got a disease, I don't know what's wrong with me, I got a rash on my leg, something like that. That's the old show. That's where you were. But here's the good news. Nobody heard that. There's nobody in Canada. The tune-in audience for Dave Letterman on a bad night is larger than the whole population of the Dominion of Canada. That's why we're going to take your brand global. I'm not talking about 10 people sitting around talking about Glenn Gould.
Earl, can I say something?
Absolutely.
Listen, I appreciate your effort, you know, but I mean you've never listened to Wiretap, and I hear you know you're using a lot of like marketing lingo from the industry and everything, but I don't feel like there's a lot of heart behind
what you're.
I'm just
going to put you on
speaker.
Yeah. Let me tell you a story here. You want to keep doing what you're doing. You're going to keep living in your schmucky little house in Schmuckville with your fat wife. But if you want to make some beautiful music together, I think we could do it. Because you could be dining on coconut curry shrimp with Pierce Brosnan, or you could be in your house eating schmuck sandwiches. And that choice is up to you, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So you think about what you want, and then you let me know. And when you're ready, I'm ready. All right, Jonathan. And you just remember that the name Jonathan Goldberg could be an international brand.
It's
whenever you're ready.
Yeah, right.
Okay? This is not show personal, my friend. This is show business.
Okay, thanks, Earl.
Okay.
Bye-bye. California.
On Wiretap today, you heard Howard Chakowitz, Dina Goldstein, and Gregor Ehrlich. Wiretap is written and performed by Jonathan Goldstein and produced by Jonathan Goldstein with Sarah Gilbert and Carolyn Warren. Production help from Mira Burt-Wintonic. You can reach us through our website at cbc.ca/wiretap.